Do you remember 33 degrees on the 13th of September? That's amazing, right? But fewer of you perhaps remember that just 3 months before, in June, we got torrential rainfall in Flanders with a combined damage of 150 million euros. And that in June alone was the same amount in the entire year of 2015. Both this extremely late heat wave and these torrential floodings that we experienced this year, these are examples of extreme weather phenomena that occur progressively more frequently in a climate that gets rapidly warmer. But there's another effect lurking around the corner. These small phenomena, they impact a certain amount of people because they cannot cool their house enough or their basement gets flooded. But this effect, this impacts us all at the same time. And I'm talking about sea level rise. Sea levels have risen already with 12 centimeters since the 1950s here at the coast of Belgium. And the sea levels are rising, of course, because the climate gets warmer. The oceans get warmer, so they expand. Greenland is starting to melt. Earth's glaciers are starting to melt. And there's one other contributor, and that's called Antarctica. We are slowly awakening this sleeping giant on the other side of the world. Antarctica is a massive ice sheet. It's around 400 times as large as Belgium. And it contains so much ice that if all this ice would disappear into the ocean and melt, the sea levels would rise with 60 meters, 6-0. Of course, this is science fiction. This is a dystopia, and it won't happen in our lifetime. But I would like to try to convince you that Antarctica will play a big role for us and for the future generations. Antarctica is basically a big rocky basin which is filled with ice. In the interior, Antarctica has around 4 kilometers thick ice. And that ice comes from snowfall that is turning into ice. While around the continent, there is sea ice, and sea ice is frozen ocean water. This is not snowfall. And because the ice sheet is so thick in the interior, the ice is starting to flow from the center towards the margins of the ice sheet, where it gets into contact with the ocean. And where it does that, we call these things ice shelves. Ice shelves are thick plates of ice that float into the ocean. And ice shelves are extremely important for my story, for the stability of the Antarctic ice sheet. In fact, Donald Trump would really like ice shelves because they are gatekeepers. They are the border control of Antarctica. They control how much ice upstream from the ice sheets is flowing into the ocean. And they do that by forming a barrier. They resist the ice from the ice sheet from flowing into the ocean. Well, suppose if one of these ice shelves gets unstable, gets thinner, then this border control disappears. And then the ice is actually allowed to freely flow into the ocean. And that leads to sea level rise. So this illustrates the tight interaction between climate change, climate warming, ice shelf instability, and sea level rise. And actually, this is not some future idea. This has already happened. And this has happened in this tiny area here with the red, denoted with the red arrow, called the Larsen B Ice Shelf. In fact, the Larsen B Ice Shelf is no longer with us. In 2002, in just a few weeks' time, in February and March, this entire chunk of ice, with the size of a Belgian province, more or less, actually disappeared, broke off and disappeared in the ocean and was replaced with ice-filled ocean water. Back then, in 2002, the scientific community was completely surprised. We didn't know where this came from. And we only understood until we were looking at the surface of this ice shelf. And when we did this, we saw this clear blue meltwater lakes on the surface of the Larsen B ice shelf. And these meltwater lakes, they are important since they can cause these fractures into the ice shelf, creating ice shelf instability. And these meltwater lakes were there because prior to 2002, there was a series of warm summers creating so much meltwater that was not able to refreeze and form these lakes. So, Antarctica looks like a very remote place, but in fact it's remarkably similar to Europe or to any other continent, being that the western part on the left side for you is very different than the eastern side on the right side. East Antarctica is actually much bigger and much colder than West Antarctica. So until recently, we thought that all these meltwater processes, ice shelf instability, was limited to the western part. But we were wondering, is this also possible in East Antarctica, in the bigger ice sheet? And that led us to organizing an expedition to East Antarctica, funded by the InBev brewery here in Leuven. And we camped on the Roi Baudouin Ice Shelf, the King Baudouin Ice Shelf, yes, named after our former king. And that's because this area is actually Belgian territory. It's very near to the Belgian research base, Princess Elisabeth. And we camped on the ice shelf two summers in a row. And we did not only camp, of course. We were there for science. We did scientific measurements, weather measurements, snow measurements, and so on. And we learned a lot about what happened, what the local conditions were. It was really a fantastic experience. Look and hear the howling wind and the low visibilities in the poor weather conditions, the cold and the snow. But many people asked me beforehand and afterwards, how cold was it actually? Actually, it wasn't cold at all. Most mornings I woke up in my thick sleeping bag sweating because the sun was heating up my tent. It was actually very, very warm sometimes, very warm. But we didn't really expect what we saw when we were traveling on the ice shelf. And I hope this will work. Okay, there we go. So at some point, we were traveling on the ice shelf and you heard water flowing. And then when we approached this, we saw this huge meltwater stream. This is all melted ice and snow flowing with 20,000 liters per second past us. And when we followed this water downstream, so we followed the water and we saw at some point it disappeared. Actually, it disappeared into the ice shelf in a big hole in the ice shelf. And this is called a moulin. A moulin is typically found on Greenland, maybe on West Antarctica, but that's never seen on East Antarctica. And this hole actually drains all the water, this 20,000 liters per second, all the way from the surface of the ice shelf down to the bottom of the ice shelf, and perhaps, as you can see here, all the way into the ocean. What we also did, we drilled into the snow on the ice shelf. We mechanically drilled in the ice shelf. So what we are interested in is the climate in the past. The deeper we go into the ice shelf, the further we go back in time. And this is what you typically see when you do this, when you take out this core of snow and ice. There's snow layer coming from the winter snow, an ice layer coming from the summer melt, and then a new snow layer coming from the winter. But this is not what we saw when we were drilling in the Roi Baudouin ice shelf. We didn't see snow or ice. We did see, as you can see here, water coming out of the drill, liquid water. And when we were turning down the drill, as you will see, there was not a nice core of fern, snow or ice. It was actually slush, as we call it. It was snow filled with water. And then when we looked into the borehole, we saw water standing in the borehole, so we were really interested, hey, what's going on there? So we decided to lower a camera in the borehole, as you can see now. So we're going down into the borehole. First, we see lots of ice with air bubbles, very typical. 4 meters deep, at some point, we come in a submarine world. We come in a subglacial lake, around 1 kilometer across, 4 meters deep, as far as the camera eye can see. So we're actually standing on a subsurface lake 4 meters deep below the surface. And these are the kind of meltwater features that we have never expected to see in Antarctica. So we were really amazed by this. But it's spectacular, of course, but as a scientist, we are wondering, what does it mean? Well, it means this. Actually, These meltwater processes, they are linked to ice shelves becoming unstable, and ice shelves becoming unstable makes Antarctica unstable. And Antarctica is not Las Vegas. What happens in Antarctica does not stay there. So ice loss from Antarctica will automatically lead to sea level, also here in Flanders. This is the most state-of-the-art contribution into the future from Antarctica to sea level rise. So you can see on the vertical axis the sea level rise in meters, going 500 years into the future until 2500. And you can see three lines, and these three lines are not there by accident. They are there because they represent our decisions, our emissions. The red line represents dystopia, the way as we continue now, while the black line represents a situation where you quickly transition to a sustainable society. And blue is somewhere in between. And just to give you some numbers, in 100 years from now, it varies between more than 1 meter, according to the red scenario, and just a couple of centimeters in the blue, in the black scenario. And in 2500, 500 years from now, we're talking about less than 20 centimeters in the black line and almost 20 meters of sea level rise in 500 years from Antarctica only. And this is how it looks like in Flanders, 20 meters. All the blue area will be flooded. Well, basically, all of Flanders will be flooded, most of it at least. So look up your hometown and see if it's holding up. If you're living in Leuven or in Brussels, and you're sick of standing in a traffic jam going to the coast, it won't be necessary anymore. You can go by bike. And we won't have our famous Belgian problem, because Flanders will be gone and Wallonia will be safe. But on the downside, of course, we will lose all our historical cities. Bruges will be underwater, Ghent and Antwerp as well. So these are the possible consequences of our emissions. If we supposedly transition to a quickly transition to a green society, we end up with a few centimeters, a few tens of centimeters. This is how 50 centimeters looks like without taking additional measures, such as increasing the height of the dikes, and that's possible. It's costly, but it's possible. So it comes down to us, how Antarctica will evolve in time and how Flanders will look like into the future. So how can we decide on this? We can decide on the way we move, we can decide on the way we live and where we live, how we live, and we can decide on how we eat. Probably all of you know that transport constitutes a huge fraction of the global greenhouse emissions. It's 13%. Cars, trucks, trains, ships, and planes, 13% of global CO2 emissions. What fewer of you know is that only cattle contributes 5% more than all the transport combined, only almost 20% of global greenhouse emissions. And that's because these animals are there because of us, because we are notorious meat eaters. We eat 80 kilograms of meat more as a Belgian per year. And that's 40% more than we actually need, than what is actually healthy. It's also 40% of our total CO2 consumption for food, and equivalent to driving around with a fuel-efficient car for 1 year, 15,000 kilometers, of course, providing that the software of the car is correct. We also need a lot of space for our meat-rich diet. We need around half a football field for each of us. And we don't need this football field to grow our fruits or our vegetables. We need this because we need to grow the food for the animals. The animals eat the food, we eat the animals. Suppose we get rid of the meat, we can provide the land use for 20 of us if we don't eat this meat anymore. Actually, I tend to feel guilty when I ruin the smell, the fresh air in our bedroom at night, and I'm probably not the only one. And the reason why the smell is there is because of methane. And methane is a very powerful greenhouse gas. But in fact, you and I shouldn't feel so guilty, because cows are much more efficient in this than us. In fact, cows emit 120 kilograms per year of methane, and that's 15 times as much as a sheep, 100 times as much as a pig, and 1,000 times as much as you or me. So livestock contributes to 95% of our annual methane emissions. So what's on our everyday plate really determines how much Flanders will be below sea level in the future. So by eating meat, we contribute immensely to global warming, to land degradation, and eventually to sea level rise. But there are, of course, alternatives. You don't need to become vegetarian, right? You can change, for instance, to chicken, and that's already 10 times less detrimental to the environment than red meat. So a less meat or meatless society, that's maybe my personal utopia, but I think as a citizen, I hope it will be possible. And as a scientist, I know it will have a cooling effect on the climate. So reducing your meat consumption will not only decrease your personal impact on the environment, but also, unless many other incentives to combat climate change, it's free. It doesn't cost you anything. So in conclusion, as if you haven't had enough reasons to reduce your meat consumption, I just give you another one, to save this fantastic place called Antarctica. Thank you very much.